I'm Stephanie Palmer, and I am a lecturer here in the Cambridge Law Faculty, and I am chairing this session. And we initially had three speakers for today's session, but unfortunately, Ian Brown is ill and is not able to attend, so we have two speakers instead. And our first speaker today will be Mary Aiken. And she is a cyberpsychologist, and she assures me that she's going to explain what that means. And she has a PhD in forensic cyberpsychology from Middlesex. She's an adjunct professor at University College Dublin, professor of the practice of cyber analytics, and director of the CyberPsychology Research Centre. And so she specializes in the intersection between technology and human behavior. She also acts as an academic advisor to the European Cyber Crime Centre and a member of the Interpol Specialist Group. And she's also a producer of the television show CSI Cyber, which was inspired by her work as a cyberpsychologist. So let us welcome Mary then. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you to the team at CRASSH, John and David and Daniel and Nora for inviting me to be here. Just the caveat for the last piece there about CSI, first and foremost, I'm an academic. Nobody was more surprised than me to get a call from CBS saying that they were interested in making a television show based on my work. I actually thought it was a hoax until they kept calling. And eventually, when I turned up in Hollywood for a 15-minute meeting that I actually thought was with an intern called Nina, turned out to be the president of CBS. 15 minutes turned into 3 hours, and they stood up at the end of the session and they said, "We'd like to make a television show, a CSI series based on your work." And I issued the mortal words, "Can I get back to you?" Because I had to go and check with the agencies that I work with Europol, with Interpol, to see if it was okay with them, because I'm an academic who works with police, but I'm not law enforcement. And effectively, there's a golden rule about you're either in policing or you're out, and entertainment is certainly out. But the reason I got involved in the show was effectively it gave me an incredible platform to educate and to actually reach out to audiences worldwide and to embed my own theories of cyber safety and security, and to do it in 170 countries simultaneously, far more people than will ever read an academic paper. So I'm a professor of cyber analytics at Hawaii Pacific University. We have an institute there for resilience and sustainability. I'm an adjunct at UCD, and I'll be taking up a professorship at Middlesex shortly. I've been running the CyberPsychology Research Centre for a couple of years, and it's now becoming the CyberPsychology Research Network, where I'm creating an international network of universities and centers of excellence who are interested in cyberpsychology and where cyberpsychology can add value. So anybody from an academic institution, if you're interested in joining this network, it's a collective network, to actually facilitate transdisciplinary research. And I add to transdisciplinary research, I want to say transinstitutional as well. I think these are global issues, so the more universities we can involve in a research project, the better to actually get that international perspective. So I'm going to talk a little about privacy. We've been talking about privacy in many different ways today, but I'm going to focus on sort of human factors in a cyber context. And I love this quote. It says that claims for the independence of cyberspace are based on a false dichotomy. Physical and virtual are not opposed, but the virtual complicates the physical and vice versa. So when we talk about the real world and the cyber world or the virtual world, there's often a process where we think that these are two different things. But what happens in a cyber context impacts on real world and vice versa. And this too is true for privacy. So what is cyberpsychology? Cyberpsychology is the study of the impact of emerging technology on human behavior. So it's part of applied psychology, and effectively it's about 15 years old as a discipline, which is very young. And when I first came across it, it was just a light bulb moment. I first studied psychology back in the day pre-internet, and when I first came across artificial intelligence in the late 90s, I thought, wow, this is fantastic. And I thought about the applications for kids, say, with learning difficulties or autism spectrum. And I thought about interacting with chatbots online. And then almost immediately, I thought, my goodness, but would it be a good effect? In other words, would it be good for their communication skills, or would it actually just create another loop that they actually would compromise their ability to communicate in a real world face-to-face environment? And it was at the point I started looking at the literature and I came across cyberpsychology and I thought, wow, this is it. This is the answer. Everybody told me I was wrong at the time. They said, cyber what? It will never last. It's, you know, the internet is a, it's a fad. Social networks won't last. This was, you know, 96, 97. And now I'm delighted to say cyberpsychology is going from strength to strength. I've worked with everybody from the White House on research teams, technology solutions to technology facilitated human trafficking, through to every agency in the US that will reach out and ask me for my input. And I go as an academic to say, look, here's what we want from cyberspace. Here's the greater good. And I'm happy to talk to anybody at any venue who will actually look at the bigger picture. You know, I like to say that technology was designed to be rewarding, engaging, and seductive for normal population. Did anybody really think about the impact on criminal, deviant, or vulnerable? And that's my area of expertise. So my specialist area is forensic cyberpsychology. So just to explain, forensic science is the physical evidence at the crime scene. I've touched the podium. It's not a crime scene, it's a podium. And basically my fingerprints are here. In television terms, that would be CSI Las Vegas. Forensic psychology is the behavioral evidence at a crime scene. So what we call the blood spatter of the mind. So in TV terms, that would be Criminal Minds as a show. My area, forensic cyberpsychology, is criminal behavior manifested in a cyber context. If anybody can repeat that, there'll be a prize. So in TV terms, that would be CSI Cyber. So our focus as cyber psychologists is internet psychology. And we also study virtual environments, artificial intelligence, intelligence amplification, digital convergence, mobile networking devices. And Jan, who published the Encyclopedia of Cyber Behavior, said that that research in this area would continue to go from strength to strength because of the pervasive and profound influence and impact of the internet on human population. Now, the EU likes to conceptualize the internet as in a structural way. They like to think of it as a motorway or a pipeline. It is many things, but it is not simply an infrastructure. It has the ability to profoundly change how humans behave. So, what do cyber psychologists do? Well, if we think about it in math and sort of a Venn diagram terms, here we have the human and we have technology. Behavioral scientists always get upset when I talk about humans, but I say human just to differentiate from machine intelligence. So here we have very human entities, and what we can see is privacy, dignity, welfare, rights, education, environment, and technology. And cyber psychologists offer insight at that intersection between the human and technology. Or as law enforcement say, merry works where humans and technology collide. And this is an ongoing and evolving area when you look at these continuous evolution of behavior. So I like to call this the cyber matrix, and it's behavior, human behavior in a cyber context. And I differentiate cyber from online because cyber pertains to anything digital. So we're all familiar with anonymity, and I'll come back and talk about anonymity in a minute. Altruism, a positive aspect. I always get accused of being so negative about technology, but I actually point out the problems to introduce balance. We have enough people who dwell, you know, on hell-bent cyber utopianism. We need some balance in the argument to say it's not all good. So think of my arguments in the context of the greater debate, and then we will have balance. Online disinhibition effect. This is an important construct, the work of Suller, 2004. And the online disinhibition effect dictates that people will do things in an online context that they will not do in the real world. And that has real implications for privacy. And if we think about privacy, there's so many aspects of it that mutate given context. So let's think about it in a temporal way, in terms of age-bound, generational construct of privacy. My definition of privacy is not the same as an 18-year-old's definition of privacy. We're using the same label, but we have different meanings. And in addition to that, privacy in the real world, in terms of legal constructs, is very different, I believe, to privacy in a cyber context. I think that they need to be treated in a different way. I think that we have underestimated the difference between real and virtual in terms of how we address many of the problems that we see day to day. So let's take something like cyberbullying. Real world bullying is a problem. Why? Because there is no evidence. A word in the playground, a punch, there's no evidence. Cyberbullying is nothing but digital evidence. How did we ever get to a point where it was a bigger problem than real world bullying? And if you look at cyber stalking, real world stalking, one-on-one transaction, modus operandi, follow somebody around. Motive is to get that glimpse of intimacy into the person's life. Cyber stalking, on the other hand, the motive is the glimpse of intimacy, but actually the access gives full details of that person's life, everything, their diary, their photograph, their correspondence. In addition to that, the MO, the modus operandi, is not to follow around, which is very labor intensive, but actually to do so remotely. Why? Because technology affords them the ability to do so. And we see cyberstalkers stalking multiple victims simultaneously, and we see the emergence of female cyberstalkers that we don't actually see, which are very rare in a real-world stalking context. So if you have a condition that is differentiated on three major points, are you still talking about the same phenomenon? So I think academically, behavioral sciences have been a little, passive about just putting cyber in front of something and saying it's the same thing. I believe it can be very different. So three things: cyber presence, cyber presentation, and cyber immersion. So these are constructs in terms of being immersed in cyberspace. How many times have you sat down to do a quick email when you've got 30 minutes before you need to go to get changed to go out for dinner and an hour has gone by? Just like that. It's very hard to track time when you're online because you are immersed in the space. And effectively, these three constructs are really about impression management online, the self that we project, the person you are on LinkedIn, the person you are on Facebook, the person that you want to be on Twitter. So when it comes to privacy, there is a management aspect, and Christina this morning was talking about accessible. So it's really how much information do we make that is accessible about ourselves? And how do we manage that? So it's the curation of self online, which is very different to the curation of self in a real world context. And we have to think about privacy in the same way. So you can have an impression of me standing and here talking to you, but that's very different to the impression that I could actually, in terms of impression management, project online, which in turn creates impression formation of how you perceive me. So again, we can't just think of privacy as one entity. We have to think about it real world, and we have to think about it in a cyber context. And we have to do this before both of these merge. So the point that we're sitting in our smart cars and our smart homes and our smart cities, and we are immersed in technology, it's going to be very difficult to see that difference and to see what real world meant and what cyber meant. Also, privacy paradox. This is a construct that comes from cyberpsychology, or adds to the body of literature in cyberpsychology. And it's this generational construct. And it's a form of cognitive dissonance where young people of a certain age will feel compelled to share images online. So I see this with Interpol in the Crimes Against Children unit. And we'll get reports of explicit and decent images posted as people's social media profile pic. And when you talk to them and you'll say, well, what were you thinking of that you would put that image up there in that way? And they'll say, but I only shared it with 500 of my friends. That is privacy to a 15-year-old. So basically, this paradox, this cognitive dissonance, also impacts on privacy, what you want to share, what you feel compelled to share, what you shouldn't share, and how you actually reconcile all of those. And then this temporal aspect of a young person who's grown up immersed in the internet and where certain standards have become normalized and socialized, and how they view privacy, and then how a parent can actually educate them about privacy. So you've got a generational clash there. So effectively, escalation online. So I've been involved in lots of different research silos, everything from cyberchondria, which is a form of hypochondria manifested online, through to organized cybercrime. And the one thing that I notice, and it's anecdotal, is that wherever technology interfaces with the base disposition, the result tends to be amplified and escalated online. I'm sure it's almost a mathematical calculation. I'm writing a book about this at the moment, and it comes out in August, and it's called The Cyber Effect. And it's the difference between real-world behavior and cyber behavior, and that amplification and escalation piece. I'll come back to minimization and status of authority online. And cyber socialization, you know, when we have somebody like Mark Zuckerberg announcing that privacy is no longer a social norm, I just wonder, as a society, why are we so passive? Why do we just accept something like that? And why do we not push back? Why do we adopt each new emerging technology with the collective wisdom of lemmings leaping off a cliff? Just because it's new does not mean it's good. Just because it's fun does not mean it's good. And when I see a company like Snapchat creating a platform where an image can be sent and it can dissolve, that is actively facilitating teenage sexting, which is facilitating the generation and distribution of child pornography, albeit of yourself if you're a minor, then that raises serious moral and ethical questions. And that's really the space that I want to talk about, is cyber ethics. We can't regulate quickly enough for technology. Governance is going to be difficult. But there are certain things that we should be able to agree on in an ethical context that should be global standards. So there's lots of interest in cyberspace from psychologists, cognitive, social, educational, organizational. I think to a certain extent, the behavioral sciences have been blindsided by evolutions in technology and understanding the impact of technology on human behavior, and then being able to advise statutory authorities or parents in terms of that impact. I think there's a major challenge to the behavioral sciences, that can we really say that theories that have been conceptualized, tested, and validated in the real world are still applicable online? Are we still measuring the same thing in the same way? So do we need to modify those theories, or do we need to develop new ones? Personally, I'm a fan of a grounded theory approach to research in this area under cyber methodology, because it gives you a chance to actually create a theoretical model that is grounded in the data and therefore has a better chance of being relevant. So, and also, I really, really, as I said, emphasize this, the need for a transdisciplinary approach. We used to say that the problem with psychology was that for too long it's lived on a diet of white mice and college students. The problem with technology is that for too long it's lived on a diet of data devices and tech experts. We really need other disciplines to get into this space and actually help conceptualize this space. So one of the questions was, what was the relation of privacy to anonymity? And anonymity is such a powerful construct. If we think back to mythology, the premise of invisibility was a superpower. This is such a powerful entity, and it comes with great responsibility. And I think there's a major question to be asked whether we should allow anonymity to remain as a construct online. Now, before everybody starts screaming about dissidents, okay, here's the thing. Let's balance the interests of dissidents with also the interests of children who are mercilessly cyberbullied or people who are trolled online, or cyber criminals who operate under the cover of anonymity. Just societies balance these relative entities and have a discussion about them. So also one of the questions talked about the notion of informed consent. And I want to actually, you know, so much of the debate about privacy and data protection really pertains to adults. I'm very, very concerned about minors and who's looking out for their interests. And there was a recent debate about the age of digital consent. Somebody in the EU proposed 16, which I was actually quite pleased with, because I think that parents should know what their kids are doing and should have mechanisms. You see social networking companies that say 13 is the minimum age, yet what is done to enforce it? What is done to enforce it? We do not expect parents to man the doors to public houses to make sure the children don't buy alcohol. Why have we made parents almost exclusively responsible for children in a cyber context? It's not fair. In an age of ubiquitous technology, society has a duty of care to protect minors. At the moment, I'm involved with the Hague Justice Portal. I sit on the advisory board there, and I've launched a consultation period to actually look at amending the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child to actually enshrine the rights of a child in a cyber context. And effectively, if you look at the UN Convention again on the rights of a child, no digital, no internet, no cyber. And effectively, it dictates, the current convention dictates, that a child has a right to a healthy mental and physical development. Now, when we talk about privacy, there are a couple of things that I would really, really like that they were kept private online. And they are legal but age-inappropriate content. So adult pornography, extreme violence, torture, suicide sites, self-harm sites. These are entities that should never be accessible by children. So you either can say, well, we have to take kids off the internet until we get this sorted out, or you either make an internet that is fit for purpose. US military have a thing called CyberNet and NipperNet. It's an internet within an internet, so they can freely communicate on those forums. Why can't we have a NipperNet for kids? And I've been involved, I was on an Irish government committee where we looked at this whole problem space. And in Germany, they have takedown notices for suicide sites and for self-harm sites. And that's just confined to Germany, but at least they're doing something about it. Imagine if we did a global initiative that actually looked to address these issues. But the point at which an 11-year-old child who's feeling vulnerable or has body dysmorphic issues, the point at which they enter thin into search and press return, and the algorithmic interface leads them to the horrendous pro-anorexia sites that not only validate but socialize and normalize their behavior, who is ethically responsible for that transaction? And we're now in a transition period whereby we're moving from standard algorithms on search, or at least Google has announced it, to deep learning, which is a learning algorithm as opposed to a rule-based algorithm. And the engineers admit that they may lose some control over that process. So we will have less control than we have now. So these are the issues that concern me. One of the quotes from our reading material that we were given was actually to, and I liked this quote because it talked about the impact of leisure on privacy and how the radio and television expanded the mental universe of the consumer. As a cyberpsychologist, I would fundamentally believe that cyberspace is an environment, and therefore we think of it in terms of environmental psychology, of being in an environment and your behavior being impacted by that environment. So it's interesting to think of cyberspace and its impact on mental universe. Another one of the quotations from our reading material was, the trend away from privacy is counterbalanced by the spread of encryption. This is really interesting. Privacy and encryption and the Apple debate, you know, backdoor was used, a pejorative term, but really, are we talking about a front door when necessary? And again, I'm somebody who's clearly, because of my police affiliation, pro-governance. And effectively, we have to think very carefully in a societal context about anything, any domain that is beyond the rule of law, and whether we can actually keep or uphold social order when you have encrypted parts that are beyond the rule of law? I mean, the real world metaphor is that you have a terrorist gang and one is captured and the other seven retreat to a basement and they're behind a secure door that's encrypted and you can't get in there to interrogate them. Would that be acceptable? No. So I think that this policy discussion at this overall level, we have to have this discussion. And I was at a debate in Washington recently, and this idea emerged, and I think it's very useful to sort of deliberate it in the context of privacy, is that there are three aims here that are in apparent conflict. You have individual privacy as a silo, you have collective security as a silo, and then you have the tech industry and the pursuit of global business vitality. So there are three entities that can be in apparent conflict. But just jumping down to bullet point three here, that do any of these have absolute primacy over each other? And I would argue no. A just society will try to balance the interests of all three. And we should be looking at governance structures that actually help us to achieve all of these aims and not one at the expense of the other, not privacy over collective security and not the vitality of the technology industry over either of the other two. And, you know, when I was mentioned minimization and status of authority online, it's a very important construct in terms of the rule of law in a cyber context, in that we're seeing behaviors, whether it's cyberbullying in kids or whether it's organized cybercrime, you know, we see these behaviors, I believe, because there is a minimization and status of authority online. There is a perception that nobody's in charge, and that is because nobody is in charge. So again, come back to that lawlessness, if you will, impacting in a virtual context. And again, there were a lot of discussions this morning about state and surveillance. I am far more worried about organized cyber criminals engaging in surveillance than any state activity. I'm far more worried about organized cyber criminals getting involved in sense making of big data than the state. But that seems to be an absolute blind spot in the debate. And the other part of the debate is in this continuum between state and citizen, where does industry sit? And who is industry accountable to? And where are their laws of governance or good practice or ethics if they are going to be the cohort that is going to dictate what is good for the rest of us? So the quotes there, again, was from a reading work, but point to this idea of control. So I think when we're talking about privacy, we also have to consider control. And where does control lie? So just to wrap up, you know, privacy, surveillance, data, identity, these are specific issues. And really what I want to do is in my talk is sort of look at the greater framework and actually create context for privacy. Because privacy is not about a 25-year-old and their data. Privacy starts with infants. Privacy runs through every age to seniors and has to fit in this architecture of the bigger issues that I see that are challenges to cyber society. So the techno, or what I call the techno-behavioral effects, so that's the impact of technology on the individual. Cyber socialization, you know, this cyber creep of behavior, how norms are changing subtly over time, with little thought and little debate in terms of that impact. Cultural implications in terms of, you know, fragmentation of the net is considered to be a bad word, but it may actually be something that allows people to culturally protect what they want for themselves and what they want for their kids. And that is not mutually exclusive to freedom of the internet. You know, it's a down to an architectural design issue. The internet spread and was built as a viral entity. If you were building a motorway, you wouldn't follow the cow path over the mountain. You would actually build a nice, clean and straight structure where you could ramp on and ramp off easily. And I think the solution to many of the problems that we see with internet-related activity is an architectural and a structural one. And I really hope that we get that debate, that it becomes a more important issue on everybody's agenda. And then temporal aspects. We're talking about privacy now. But here's the thing. Our privacy, as we perceive it now, is already compromised by the data mining engines of the future. Everything that you think is safe now, in 10 years' time, will be will be mined. And that's something to think about going forward. So I'm an advocate for better cyber society, for the greater good, and also for the important role of cyber ethics in the process. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for that far-reaching and really interesting talk. But we have one more talk this afternoon by Reuben Binns, who is a researcher at the Department of Computer Science at the University of Oxford, and he's working on the SOCIAM project. I think that's how you pronounce it. His research interests include philosophical, technical, and legal aspects of personal data privacy and the web. Thank you.
Thanks, Stephanie. Thanks, everyone from CRASSH as well, for having me to talk today. So I'm going to try and address a particular approach to privacy and personal data, which has been suggested at various times over quite a long time period. I won't be able to do justice to the full range of perspectives, but I'm going to try and do what I can to outline what I consider the most interesting aspects of it are. So the idea is treating privacy as a kind of property right. So some preliminaries. I'm going to probably be stranded somewhere in the middle of the Atlantic, looking to the States and to the UK and kind of equivocating between privacy and privacy. So forgive me, as many other speakers have today. Second of all, I'm not a lawyer, but I am fully on board with Mary's call for transdisciplinarity. My disciplinary leanings will hopefully become apparent as I go through my talk. Suffice to say, I started out in the philosophy department just down the road and drifted towards computer science, but I've tried to keep the philosophical aspects of my work alive, so hopefully those will come through today. So I'm going to try and give a bit of a historical perspective on this idea of privacy as property. I can't say I'm going to go back very far. David's chapter that was prescribed to us started in, I think it was 1900 to 1970, so I'll pick up around the late 60s, so hopefully I can at least take us back towards the end of his chapter. So there are several levels that this discourse about privacy or personal data as a type of property operate. So there's a kind of casual way that people sometimes refer to notions of ownership over data. And it's not always clear whether they mean this in a kind of robust legal sense or whether they just mean, you know, who owns the data, who has primary say or primary control over how it's used. But sometimes it is invoked in a more substantial way to kind of describe the idea that there should actually be a genuine kind of legal right that would grant people a sort of property right over their personal data, and that would enable them to protect it in various ways, to sell it, to license it out for a fee, and earn some compensation for the uses of their data. So why is this an interesting perspective to consider at this point in time, if it's been around since at least the 70s? I think the reason it's interesting to consider now is that it's starting to become a practical potentially implemented model by certain companies coming out of Silicon Valley. So I did some research on these companies. Essentially what they do is that they provide platforms that allow their users to create their own marketing profiles from scratch. They can select what information to put into those profiles. They can decide what data streams to connect to those profiles. So you could connect your social network profile, connect your tracking device, and you can select what kinds of buyers can come and see that data. So there are some of the companies. There's one called Dataku that described itself as the world's first personal data marketplace. There's Citizen Me, which offers to unlock the value of your personal data for you and on your terms. One called Autograph. They let people realize their interests, helping marketers drive response rates. Well, Handshake, another one, they estimate that their users could earn between £1,000 and £5,000 per year by selling their data. So the idea of these companies is that they want to make profiling seem more acceptable and make it actually more acceptable and hopefully avoid the kind of consumer backlash that digital marketing companies might otherwise might face, and to create a kind of mutually beneficial system for consumers and marketers. So this is why it's kind of interesting to consider now whether there is a justification for something like a strong, robust kind of legal property rights approach to personal data. And so if we were looking for ways to do that, we might go to the kind of very basic kind of natural law approaches to property rights. So someone like John Locke, his notion was that we own our bodies, and therefore by mixing our bodies with raw materials that we find, and providing that we meet certain criteria for the appropriation of those raw materials, so it leaving enough for other people and other provisos like that. But as an extension of owning our bodies, we own the fruits of that labour. We own the products and the goods that we can create through mixing our labour with natural resources. And this kind of seems like an odd way to go about justifying a property right in personal data. So in practice, it's not really what happens. I think one reason you might think that's kind of odd is that, you know, when we create personal data, it's not really equivalent to John Locke's idea of a family going out into the unowned commons and toiling the land and creating some grain or some cattle. Really, it's actually just a kind of byproduct of the way we use technology in the modern world, walking around in technologically mediated environments. Personal data seems to be a byproduct rather than something that we labour to create. Another reason you might think it sounds kind of weird is that personal data is an immaterial object. It's not a physical good like houses or land or cattle. And that in itself isn't necessarily a knockdown objection, because we have intellectual property rights, we have copyrights, patents, sui generis database rights, and these all protect immaterial goods. So it's not inherently a problem, but it does seem kind of weird, because those other intellectual property rights are justified on the basis of kind of some sort of effort that goes into either the creative effort that goes into creating copyright works, or the effort that goes into compiling a database if you have a database right. So it seems like personal data isn't really the kind of thing that would justify that kind of legal property right. So how is this seriously argued for then if that natural rights approach doesn't work? Well, normally when it comes up in the kind of legal literature, and what's often called the law and economics approach, they don't really think about natural rights. What they think about is market failures and ways to allocate goods in an optimal way. So they start by conceptualizing privacy problems as a kind of market failure. So the limited set of types of market failure. You can have problems associated with large monopolies that have too much power. There can be information asymmetries where some buyers or sellers have less information and therefore aren't able to make choices that would kind of increase their individual interests. And then finally, you've got negative externalities. So often the argument for property rights and personal data doesn't really distinguish which of these market failures the property right is supposed to correct. But I think it makes most sense to think about negative externalities. So these are cases where interactions between two parties in a market create a disbenefit for some third party who doesn't get compensated, and therefore the individuals in the exchange don't internalize the costs they're imposing on the third party. So that's the kind of usual rationale that's offered for potentially instituting a property right in personal data. And so how does that apply to the personal data case? Well, You could think about the status quo where our data gets collected either by first parties that we're interacting with. We're interacting with them for one purpose, which might be, to buy a good, and then the data that's generated from that gets used for some other purpose, which potentially has some negative effect on us. So the idea is that if you give individuals a property right over their personal data, then the companies that want to use it would have to first ask for the right to be able to do it, and the individual would be able to charge them a price that the individual felt would fairly compensate them for any potential losses that they might suffer for it being used. So, of course, instituting a property rights regime isn't the only way to deal with these negative externalities, and it's not even necessarily the most common way that you would think about. But nevertheless, advocates of this approach have kind of come out and said that this might be the best way to deal with it. And so there are kind of various problems that you might think about, practical problems like, how what would be the mechanism for charging people for access to your data? What about cases where there's an interpersonal nature to the data? So as John was saying this morning, you've got, if everyone has, if you have Gmail, your friend doesn't have Gmail, you have the data in your Gmail account concerns both yourself and other people. So how would you deal with the property rights in that case? It's generally assumed that these are kind of minor issues that can be dealt with when you're kind of working out the details of a property rights approach. So this approach was first suggested back in the 1960s by Alan Weston, who's one of the most important kind of privacy law scholars, at least in the US privacy law. And it didn't really get a positive reception at the time. And there were several objections to it, which I'll go into, but I think the most important one probably was that there was no real mechanism proposed for how you'd go about trading your personal data. Without such a mechanism, some kind of genuine free market in personal data seemed kind of impractical. But if we fast forward to the 1990s or the late 1990s, the idea begins to make a bit of a comeback in US legal scholarship. So the context for this was obviously the rise of the World Wide Web. We had people coming online, browsing the web, websites beginning to track them, surveillance-based advertising became a thing, vast amounts of personal data were being collected, generated, and were kind of sloshing around in a free-for-all. So along come the likes of Larry Lessig, Richard Murphy, Hal Varian, who began to kind of argue that maybe this property rights approach is worth looking at. So here's Professor Lessig writing in 1999. Data is an asset. As it is becoming extremely valuable, commerce has tried to exploit it. This use has a cost, an externality borne by those who would rather this data not be used. So the trick is to construct a regime where those who would use the data internalize this cost. The laws of property are one such regime. If individuals can be given the rights to control their data, or more precisely, if those who would use data had first to secure the right to use it, then a negotiation could occur over whether and how much data should be used. The market, that is, could negotiate these rights, if a market in these rights could be constructed. And in the burgeoning web that was all around at the time, this wave of innovation, Lessig was convinced that there was now going to be a solution to the transaction costs problem that kind of meant that Weston's idea of a market for privacy kind of fell on deaf ears. And in Lessig's eyes, the solution would be intelligent software agents that could negotiate with data collectors on our behalf. And so he referred optimistically to the efforts that were going on at the time in the World Wide Web Consortium. This is the standards body that convenes industry and other stakeholders to try and create standards for how the web works. And they were working on something called the Platform for Privacy Preferences, which was going to be a standard technological means for individuals to talk to organizations, or not individuals themselves, but rather the browsers that they were using to interact with these organizations via the web. So what you do is you'd configure in your browser a set of privacy preferences that you had. And as you visited a website, your intelligent software agent running in your browser would negotiate with the website and say, Reuben has these privacy preferences, what are your privacy practices, and try and see if there was a match. And if there wasn't, it would kind of go on to a negotiation protocol, which would say, okay, well, if you're not going to give me that data, then I'm going to remove this feature, or so on and so forth, until a deal that was fair to both parties had been arranged, and then you proceed to use the website. So Lessig was interested in potential for this software to take over the burdensome work of negotiating a price for personal data. So this would allegedly enable a kind of fast, efficient market for personal data, which would appropriately balance the values of privacy that the individuals have with the utility that the collectors wanted to get out of the data. Now, unfortunately, or perhaps fortunately, the standard never really took off. There was a version of the standard which got quite a lot of interest for a few years, which was a pared down version, which didn't have this negotiation features. It was simply a way for websites to declare their privacy practices. Unfortunately, there's a long and interesting history of the attempts to get this standard to work, but in the end, it kind of ended up being dropped by most websites and browsers. So it never really evolved to be able to enable the kind of dynamic negotiation that Lessig was hoping it might be able to. But now we're seeing these new platforms that I mentioned coming along. You know, they seem to have venture capital funding. They seem to have a potential way that they can monetize personal data. So, you know, maybe we're finally there at the position where we could start to create these kinds of markets. So it's an interesting time to ask the question, is this a good idea? Should we encourage these markets for personal data, or are there reasons to be skeptical? So the question of whether it would work on a practical level, I think, is one for economists and technologists to answer. Market equilibrio difficult to model and even harder to achieve in practice, but you know, maybe there's work to be done there. But I'd prefer to actually step away from discussions about market failure, about correcting markets in kind of narrowly economic terms, and discuss this idea of property right in personal data from a non-economic perspective. So these alternative perspectives that I'm wanting to get to have already been hinted at in the responses to the legal literature on this. At the time when Alan Weston proposed this property rights approach, his contemporary Arthur Miller responded that the basic objection to the property theory is that real and personal property concepts are irrelevant to the personal values that we're attempting to preserve by recognising a right to privacy. This new wave of enthusiasm for personal data ownership and personal data markets that has emerged in recent years has also provoked similar responses. So one of the responses is what I would kind of roughly call the kind of anti-neoliberal response. So this critique focuses on the kind of neoliberal mindset that this personal data ownership allegedly implies. So the argument here is that, you know, while purporting to be a kind of revolutionary alternative to the status quo that would kind of enfranchise people to become kind of beneficiaries of their own data, actually that the argument is this approach merely, you know, reinforces some of the negative perspectives on big data, or the kind of the big data paradigm. And so for sociologist Daniel Nayland and others, they say we could see these platforms as the latest in an ever-growing list of supposed market solutions. They act as instruments of calculative power and reflect a neoliberal promise of a responsible citizenry. In a more alarmist version of this analysis, in a recent book by Jacob Silverman, he portrays the idea of these personal data ownership platforms as a particularly pernicious manifestation of big data-driven neoliberalism. I quote, "This is to give in to the logic of big data. Rather than trying to dismantle or reform the system, they wish to universalize it, This model would make all of human life part of one vast automated data valence system. No social or behavioural act would be immune from the long arms of neoliberal capitalism, because everything would be tracked, everything you do would be part of some economic exchange, benefiting a powerful corporation far more than you. This isn't emancipation through technology, it's the subordination of life, culture and society to the cruel demands of the market. Similarly, the technology critic Ergenei Morozov says that to some, the very idea that our every decision is a piece of data to be monetized might seem appalling, and rightly so. He's commenting there on a book by Jaron Lanier, who advocated for a kind of micropayment system that would fund the web based on people being paid for their data. So Morozov argues that this approach encourages the data subject to become, in Foucault's words, an entrepreneur of the self, always eager to cash in on some personal trivia. The argument here is that monetizing personal data only serves these neoliberal capitalist motives with some inevitably corrupting effects on society and the self. And the world that these critics portray arising as a result of personal data platforms is a frightening and perhaps plausible one. And I am somewhat sympathetic to the view. I think it mischaracterizes these platforms in two ways. First of all, it's not clear that they uncritically accept the logic of big data. I think arguably in asking individuals to question, evaluate, and shape the data that defines them, these platforms actually invite their users to engage in critical reflection on some of the epistemic, ontological, and normative aspects of big data. You can see this in the marketing efforts of these platforms. They frequently appeal to consumers' anxiety and skepticism about the status of data currently used to profile them. I've got some quotes from the marketing material here. One argues that when it comes to the story of you, this joined up mass of data threads can't even be described as an unauthorized biography. The performative and fragmented and negotiated nature of digital marketing profiles is also embraced in their marketing literature. One of them describes how the platform allows the user to step up to the digital mirror to see who you have created and curate, tweak, and opt in or out at will. So the perceived epistemological, ontological deficiencies of big data are actually used to market this alternative form of profiling. And yes, maybe this is all a cynical marketing ploy, but I think it's at least worth considering whether there's a version of it that might work. Second, the idea that some new good or service ought to be produced and consumed according to market principles isn't by itself necessarily neoliberal. If we think of neoliberalism as a kind of economic ideology, market fundamentalism, by which the whole of society ought to be run according to market logic, that's one thing. But the mere belief that certain things ought to be left to the market does not a neoliberal make. So believing that neoliberalism is bad is not a sufficient reason to dismiss personal data markets, just as it's not a reason to dismiss markets for other new kinds of goods. What we need for this anti-neoliberal critique to have bite, I think, is to consider why a market approach to personal data might be bad, or at least worse than other kinds of market exchange. We need a way to distinguish personal data from other types of things that most people are happy to run according to market principles. So thankfully, there is a significant body of work in political philosophy which deals with precisely this question, the question of the moral limits of markets. We can point to certain examples of goods whose market exchange is generally seen as morally problematic. These include things like the sale of human organs, votes in a democracy, reproductive labour, indentured servitude or slavery, toxic waste disposal, awards or professional positions that are normally based on merit. And so the idea idea that these things are problematic is not necessarily due to the idea that their exchange leaves buyers and sellers worse off than they were before. If that were their only failing, then the standard economic lens that I was talking about before might be able to kind of correct that problem. These markets might be fixed by using various responses to market failure, including perhaps property rights. But these kinds of markets seem morally problematic, regardless of any redistribution of benefits, for reasons that are more readily understood through a political or ethical lens rather than an economic lens. So one theory about why these kinds of goods are kind of morally repugnant if they're turned into a marketable good is that the social meaning of the good becomes corrupted. So this is Michael Waltz's argument. Basically, he takes the example of a friendship. So if friendship becomes a good which is traded and sold, that kind of degrades the meaningfulness of friendship. Another slightly different account of the moral limitations of markets comes from Deborah Satz, and this is one I prefer. Her perspective is that it's not about the intrinsic nature of the good, but rather about the context in which the exchange takes place and the effect it has on relationships between buyers and sellers. So markets in these types of goods, Satz claims, inevitably put certain people in an unequal social standing, even if they increase each party's individual material position. A market for votes, for example, is not wrong because it fails to allocate benefits optimally. It's a win-win for the vote seller and the vote buyer, but rather because it undermines a necessary condition for democracy, the idea that each citizen has equal standing. And actually, intriguingly, this perspective was kind of hinted at in some of the earlier critiques of the property rights approach. This is Pamela Samuelson writing quite a long time ago, I think in the early 2000s, in response to this idea of personal data as a property right. She says, if information privacy is a civil liberty, it may make no more sense to propertize personal data than to commodify voting rights. So I think there's a kind of the seeds of that kind of critique were already present in those earlier critiques. So I'm not in a position to fully argue for that perspective, but I do think there's a case to be made, perhaps, that in certain circumstances, personal data might be considered to be in this general category of goods. I'm not implying that it's the sale of personal data is necessarily as morally repugnant as the sale of a vote in a democratic society, but it's on the same within the same kind of category for similar reasons. So we've heard various accounts of why privacy is important, and in order to kind of justify this notion that personal data is something that shouldn't be sold, I would encourage appeals to various defences of privacy that we've heard today. From the notion that it is essential to protect individual creativity. A particular phrase I really like from German constitutional law is that privacy is there to protect, I think in this case it was the notion of informational self-determination, which is slightly different. It was there to protect die freie Entfaltung der Persönlichkeit. I'm sorry if I've mangled my German pronunciation there, but I think it translates roughly to something like the free unfolding or the free development of personality. So that's kind of one of my favourite ways to argue for privacy. But however we argue for it, I think that it's important to have an articulation of why it is that personal data is not the kind of thing that we want to permit kind of a free market exchange for. So this doesn't need to imply that the sale of personal data should be banned outright. Perhaps we could have softer forms of regulation. But the point here is that there may be moral or political reasons to intervene in personal data markets that go beyond the kind of standard economic perspectives. General conclusion being that even if consumers become enfranchised producer vendors in the current market for personal data, they may still end up sacrificing a degree of autonomous decision-making power or whatever the other defence of privacy that we have. And the fact that they get paid for their data in the process may not seem particularly empowering. So I think as a provocation, it's an interesting one, the idea that we could own our data and charge people for it. I think it's an interesting provocation, but I don't think it's a real solution to the moral problems of personal data and privacy. But I think to conclude, I think there's two things that are worth perhaps saving or at least considering from this discussion of personal data as privacy. So the first one is we could draw a parallel between privacy and personal property. This is closer to the idea of rights in personal effects. So we can distinguish private assets or private property in general from personal property. Personal property being things that we have to use on a day-to-day basis, clothes, toothbrushes, things that people don't really want to buy once they've been used. And I think this is kind of closer to what Weston had in mind when he was proposing a property rights approach. He was worried that, you know, in the US at the time, you know, privacy wasn't very well protected. It was a tort. You needed to show damage as a result of a privacy breach. But his argument was that if it was a kind of property right, then they might perhaps be better protected. So for Weston, the point of considering personal data or privacy as property wasn't because he wanted to create this kind of enfranchised class of consumer producers selling their data. It was actually in order to afford better protection in a similar way to the personal property would be protected. So the primary concern isn't enforcement of intellectual property rights. Okay. But rather to protect people's privacy. Final thought. There's a notion of ownership of our own bodies. There's something that it feels like to have one's own body as opposed to someone else's body. And so perhaps there's a similar parallel to be made with personal data. Maybe we feel that we own our personal data in a phenomenological sense, even if there isn't a corresponding legal right. And this is something I was talking to Mary about just before I started, that, you know, maybe there is something to that. So I'll leave it there. Sorry I ran over, but hopefully there'll be time for questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much for two really interesting talks which challenge ideas about data and how it should be used in the future. So I'd just like to invite questions. We've got a few minutes for questions before we move on to the final session. Yes, we have lots of people here. Perhaps we could start down here.
Charlie Pearson, Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. Just a quick question, Mary. I think you mentioned a reference, and it's not on your list, if I remember rightly. Anderson, 2015.
Is that it correct? Was from the materials we circulated to
us. Oh, okay. Thank you. And then just a quick question for Reuben. It's not inconsistent with what you said. I just wanted to bring out a little more because you sort of indirectly referenced it. But, I mean, one of the objections that people might say to the sort of systems that you were talking about could be that people who are actually poor might be sort of forced into selling some sort of fundamental human rights in a way that perhaps they didn't really want to, but and thereby be disadvantaged as to other people. I don't know whether you wanted to comment more on that.
Yeah,
aspect.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's the kind of the basis of a lot of those critiques, the moral market limit theorists, for want of a better term. Their worry is that, you know, the powerful will be buying more votes and the poor will be selling their own democratic rights. So yeah, there's definitely a egalitarian kind of aspect to their critiques. But actually, you know, interestingly enough, in some cases you've got the data of the poor could be more valuable than the data of the rich. If you're a payday loan site, knowing that the person who's visiting your site is already in debt might be very valuable. So you, when you look at the detail of it, the value of data is going to vary potentially between the rich and the poor.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for two interesting presentations. Questions for both speakers. First for Reuben is, just to clarify, are you saying that are we selling our personal data or are we selling the privacy of the personal data? Because I think the question with property is that it's ownership to the exclusion of others, but you're not really excluded from your own data, but the privacy of it. And I'm trying to think about it also from perspective of collective or common data, just reflecting on work by Hyde and Negri on commons as well. And you know, if the data is about networks, it's a socialized kind of production, how would that data sort of be sold? And for Mary, I think that was very fascinating, especially when you mentioned, I fully agree with the point about the architecture. And I'm just trying to think a bit more about some work done on the disposition of spaces. And I'm curious how your work, especially looking at cyber ethics and looking at and also about your methodology, engages work to do with actor network theory and thinking about how the space and the cyber objects itself reshape our reality and what that means for us.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I kind of often move between a property rights approach to privacy and property rights over personal data. So I should probably have been more clear about the distinction between the two. So your point about the commons, whether there could be some form of collective management of personal data. There's an interesting case of a cooperative in Switzerland. It was funded by a government grant, but I think it's now independent. And you can contribute your medical records to this cooperative. And by doing so, you become a member of the cooperative and you have voting rights over how the data gets used. The idea is that they build up a common pool of medical records that could be used by medical researchers. And so there are examples of collective management of personal data, which I think are interesting.
And just to your point about, as a cyber psychologist, to really try and work hard to break away from HCI, which is, you know, the human, no disrespect to anybody from that discipline in the audience, but, you know, it's not just about the size of our thumbs and about how fast the screen scrolls. And in network science, it's not the human as a node. When I talk about human factors, I'm talking about behavioral, developmental, physiological, cognitive, motive, affective factors. So the full range of what it is to be human, and then consider that in a development in an environmental context. So, and particularly for children who are actually growing up in this domain, Michael Sito, who's a great forensic psychologist, he said we're living through the largest unregulated social experiment of all time when we consider the access that children have to the internet and everything that is there. So, you know, the developmental piece worries me, and our lack of understanding of the developmental piece worries me. And at the moment, we're still in a position, you know, parents get frustrated with their kids coming to the dinner table with their mobile phones in their hands. Well, wait till you see the next generation of what's going to happen when you see them turning up in HMDUs, head-mounted display units, which is Oculus Rift and that next evolution, where, you know, you won't be able to see their face. And not only will they be psychologically immersed in this space, cyberspace, but they'll also be physically encapsulated in that space. And again, it comes back to the greater ethical piece of, yeah, just because it's new, is it good? And, you know, where is the governance?
Thank you. John?
Thank you very much, both of you. Reuben, I'm puzzled by your presentation in several ways. In the first instance, I can see your kind of philosophical and ethical concerns about this idea of people might sell their thing. But actually, the current position we have is that we have a number of giant companies which are ruthlessly exploiting the personal data of people. They know it's extremely valuable, and in the process, they're building, partly based on the thinking of Hal Varian, one of your heroes, they're building a new kind of capitalism, yeah. Basically, it's surveillance capitalism, and in that capitalist system, the users of their services don't play the same role as, say, the people who buy products from real companies, as were. So on the first case, we already have a moral outrage, right? I think in those circumstances, it would make sense to be less worried about, or less, less worried about the kind of ethical and other concerns about alternative approaches to this. That's the first point. Second point is I was interested that you didn't mention some of the big projects in this area, none of which are commercial. So, for example, you made no mention of Doc Searle's and the Harvard vendor relationship management system. You made no mention of the Warwick Cambridge hat project, and you didn't mention the Cambridge data box project, all of which are non-commercial systems which propose to create computer architectures which would level the playing field between ordinary consumers and internet companies?
So to the first point, I think perhaps the focus seems odd because I'm looking at quite a hypothetical situation, right? But I think it's worth looking at those hypothetical situations because they are a small but emerging model, and the point is not to defend the status quo or to say Halvarian is the greatest scholar of all, but rather to interrogate the proposals that have been put forward to kind of solve the problems you were talking about. As for VRM and for the HAP project and so on, I'm very much interested in all of those models. There's also this cooperative model that I was referring to earlier, all interesting. But as far as I know, the primary focus of those models isn't for people to turn their data into an asset, but rather to create a mutually beneficial data sharing arrangement with third parties who can help them in various ways, rather than use their data for nefarious purposes.
Well, in the case of the HAP project, for example, they do regard their data as an asset.
But not, as far as I understand, it's not a way of monetizing the value. But I might be wrong.
Organizing exchanges which create monetary value.
Okay. Thanks.
Well, thank you very much. It's there's a few more people who are keen to ask questions. We'll have to be really quick, so we'll have one, two, and.
Hi, I'm Maria Farrell. I work for Interconnect Communications, and I've been working in internet governance for about 20 years. Just to the comments about the internet standards, architecture, and design, guys, if you had been building it in a hierarchical way that was going to stop every time we identified a risk, that was wanting to embody in its architecture the financial and political interests of every person in power, we would not have the internet. It would never have been built. I've been working in this for a long time, and I have to tell you, the first 5 years it was telcos coming along saying, please re-engineer this whole thing to fit our business models. Then after that, it was law enforcement, and they're still at it, And the Department of Justice minister in Ireland, who is so keen to re-engineer the internet in the interest of the Department of Justice, my uncle. And if anyone ever was given enough family barrackings around the breakfast table to say, this is not what this thing is for, yes, build stuff into it. Do not re-engineer the best thing we've invented in over a century to reflect existing power structures and to shut progress down, to shut debate down, to shut people down. That's not what it's for. And I'm sorry, I deal with law enforcement a lot, and I think the mentality there is if all you've got is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. All they see are the problems. Yeah, let's solve the problems, but we're not going to re-engineer the entire thing. It's too good for that.
Okay, and it's not too good for children at the moment. It is totally unacceptable that children can access the content that they can access at the moment. And I've sat on committees. I was part of the Irish Government Internet Content Governance Group, and I sat with members of industry, and I had to sit there and listen to a person say to me that I didn't have the evidence to support that when young children looked at adult pornography that it was damaging. So at some stage, I don't need a longitudinal study to tell me that nothing good can come of an 8-year-old looking at pornography over time. And I'm not prepared to wait for that until that child is 18 and we can see the damage. At the moment, it is not fit for purpose. At the moment, in terms of children, I'm talking about those who are vulnerable. And to argue that, because it's good for business, is good for everybody. Yes, freedom of the internet, but not at any cost, and not at the cost of the rights of the child.
We had just one more question, if I could just beg you to be really brief. Thank you.
I want to go on this. Is what you're proposing, Mary, actually re-engineering the internet? Seems to me there are two areas where censorship, which is what we're talking about, is effectively applied, fairly effectively, and that's child pornography and copyrighted materials. Is there any realistic prospect of those regimes being extended?
I think that, I work with Interpol, with Crimes Against Children Group, and I think that you know, they say that one of the issues with child pornography is that normal population or people generally are never exposed to it. And I think if anybody in this room looked at the content that police have to deal with, you know, they would just be horrified and there'd be a call for action in the morning. If you look at NCMEC, which is National Centre for Missing and Exploited Children, 10 years ago, they were getting 10,000 indecent images a year. Last year, they got 20 million. So that's my world. You know, that's what we deal with. And if I call for an architectural solution, and I'm not being prescriptive, I'm not saying we have to do this. I'm just saying, guys, we need to have a conversation about this, because everything that I see at the front end, which, you know, yes, is the worst end, it is not heading in a good direction. I'll just give you one example. Sexting, you know, we're seeing the growth of sexting. And this image now, these images are obfuscating the problem because it's an indecent image of a minor. So how do police even begin to differentiate between effectively something that's a social issue in terms of sexual curiosity and something that is a victim, that there is an offender who's proximate to the victim? So difference between a 13-year-old sending an image to her 14-year-old boyfriend and somebody who's being exploited to generate content. Now, if you look at it, you know, we're seeing sexting rings in schools where children are swapping these images using hidden applications on their devices that parents have no idea about. I was in a research group whereby 9 and 10-year-old boys were talking about the content they brought to school on their phones. And one of them in the group said that if you came to school with regular hardcore pornography on your phone, you were a loser because anybody could get that. But if you could generate an original image, an indecent image of a child that was original, then you got kudos for that. Now, the only other place I've ever heard of the generation of an original image being an entry point is an adult sex offender rings, where effectively you have to generate original content to prove that you're not police and to show that you've got access to a child. So I see frontline this erosion and corruption of minors as a result of an, you know, unrestricted access. And if you were to walk into a newsagent and if you saw on the bottom shelf of the newsagent hardcore pornography magazines, extreme violence, torture, self-harm, suicide sites, or a magazine, you know, in relation to suicide, you'd be horrified. But it's there. It's available anywhere.
Well, I hasten to wrap this up on that note. But they were both really interesting and thought-provoking talks, and thank you very much. And also thank you for the people who asked questions as well. So we're now going to just have a 1 minute break.
Two or three minute break,
and then we're going to wrap up the session. So thank you. Let us thank the speakers. Thank you.